Connected with Camp Mohawk?
Well, I think so. I'm the program director, Jerry Aldini.
Well, how do you justify $1,000 a week?
Well, we have some special programs. We're doing Shakespeare in the Round again this year, of course. Our political roundtable, Henry Kissinger will appear. Yasser Arafat is going to come out, spend a weekend with the kids, just rap with them.
That's amazing.
And the kids wanted animals, so this year each camper will stalk and kill his own bear in our private wildlife preserve.
Are you sure the children can hack that?
We'll see. Hey, you have a good summer, too, huh?
Saturday Night Live's Bill Murray is a wacky summer camp counselor in Meatballs, just one of five new movies we'll be reviewing on sneak previews. Across the aisle from me, Roger Ebert, film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And this is Gene Siskel, film critic for the Chicago Tribune. Now, in addition to Meatballs, which I think I like more than Gene did, we'll also be taking a look at Farrah Fawcett Majors in Sunburn and a telethon to save the United States named Americathon, and also a gang of cops playing robbers in Hot Stuff. And now Gene starts with the CONCORDE Airport 79.
Well, they ought to retitle the whole airport series of movies Fear of Flying. Let's face it, that's what the whole thing's about. We vicariously experience the threat of a crash of a big luxury jet crammed full of stereotypes, I mean people. Now, in the fourth film in the series, the CONCORDE Airport 79, defense contractor Robert Wagner is trying to shoot down a supersonic aircraft because on the plane is reporter Susan Blakely, who has evidence that Wagner has been selling weapons to communist countries. So he sent one of his missiles after her plane, but the American government, after spotting Wagner's missile, sends some jets out to destroy it before it destroys the Concorde.
Here it comes.
F-15 is at 10 o'clock.
He's dead.
The fighter's too close. If he overshoots, we'll end up with a missile in our laps.
Movie's nothing to cheer about. That failure, unfortunately, doesn't stop Robert Wagner. He next sends a manned jet to blow up the Concorde in mid-flight, and this time some French jets go after Wagner's jet.
He's on his cannons.
Power on. Engine 2.
Engine 2. No response, sir.
Try engine 4. Power.
Starting engine 4. No flame, sir.
Oh, my God, he's straight down. Oh. There's so much fear.
She's not responding, Captain.
Engine 3, power.
Oh, dear Lord, please help us. Oh, God, no. It's the worst nightmare. Oh, God, no, please, no. We're going to the ocean. Oh, no.
Engine 3, no response, sir. Power, engine 1.
I think my feet are getting wet.
Starting flare.
Number 1, good ignition, sir.
Try number 2 again, Peter.
Ooh-wee. Thing like that could ruin his whole day.
Engine 4 running, sir. Starting 3.
Well, I did like when the toilet paper was flying around in the bathroom and the bars of soap, but I don't think as critics we go to these airport movies anymore to criticize them so much as to endure them. This one is pretty bad, awfully dull. It has very little humor, which would have helped a lot. The characters in the film are as shallow as a birdbath, and their behavior makes no sense at all. The only parts of the film that are interesting are when we think the plane might go down. And that's kind of sick, I guess.
It's kind of sick, and it's not very realistic. I mean, thinking all the way back to the first airport movie, it was more or less realistic. But in this one, look at it this way. Here's a plane that's going from Washington to Paris and then on to Moscow.
Right.
On the first leg of the flight, it's shot at by missiles. It's attacked by a jet airplane. It lands. The next morning, everybody gets on board the plane again. Would you get back on that plane until you knew who was shooting at you?
No way. And how about this? The center of the story is that Robert Wagner's trying to knock off this woman because she has the incriminating evidence. He, instead of going after her, and he could have knocked her off in Paris, he sees her in Paris in between the two flights in the picture, instead of knocking her off then, he waits till she gets back on the plane and then tries to shoot down the whole plane again. It makes absolutely no sense.
Okay, I have another small technical detail here. They must have done some research on this plane. They might have found out it's the fastest plane in the world, right? At one point, George Kennedy has been promoted to pilot, opens the window and sticks out a flare gun, you know. At 1,000 miles an hour, his hand and the rest of his body would wind up in the Canary Islands.
That's
that was really a...
Also, the special effects we could see there. You could tell when it was cartoon animation instead of real planes. It's not a good film.
So what do we look forward to, Airport 81?
I hope not. I hope this ends it. I hope it bombs out at the box office and no more airport movies.
So please, don't see this movie. Okay. Last year, when Farrah Fawcett Majors made her first movie, which was called Somebody Killed Her Husband, one critic called it a Yankee movie because Farrah was yanked here and then she was yanked there. It's a plot that called for very little, actually, in that movie, except be yanked through it. But I guess that was basically a fairly accurate review. But now Farrah's second movie has come along, and I basically like it a lot better. It's called Sunburn, and Farrah stars as a woman who's hired as a private detective's paid companion. Now, her job, provide a cover by pretending to be his wife while he tries to steal some incriminating letters.
Wait! Wait! Oh, my God.
Anyone asked if I was here all night.
What happened? Is somebody after you?
Maybe Ortega. I think the suit fooled him.
You look awful. Why don't you have a cup of coffee and sit down? Are you okay?
I'm okay. I'm okay.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Look, I know I'm not an expert. Are you sure you're going about solving this case in the right way?
Are you serious? Ortega's papers. They show that Thorne was being blackmailed, and now that he's dead, they're trying to do the same thing to Mrs. Thorne.
Are you sure? I mean, can you prove it?
Prove it? Get me some tiles. I mean, you need something a little more conclusive. But if I get it, it'll be worth $500,000.
$500,000? You're paying me $500 a day and nearly getting me killed?
Plus expenses.
You really are a rat.
I thought this was a good deal for you. You get a bonus.
It's not just the money. Now, what kind of man dresses up in a spooky suit like that and spends a night with another man's wife just to steal some papers?
Me? That's why I'm considered the fourth best guy in the business at this stuff. Could you make me some breakfast?
No, I wouldn't fix you some breakfast. Why don't you fix it yourself? Do you have any idea how old she is? I would say she was at least 40, probably still taking those change of life pills just to keep it going.
There must be some pills.
You're disgusting.
It was Charles Grodin as her husband, and he claimed there that he was the fourth best detective in the business, but he bumbles his way through the movie while Farrah saves the day, and she often saves it, I perhaps ought to add, while wearing costumes that help explain why the movie is titled Sunburn.
How you doing?
What can I do for you, pal?
Oh, my wife tells me you gave her a little scare out in the water.
She's daydreaming, pal. Lots of broads would like me to give them a little scare in the water.
Yeah, I'll bet they do. Is this really the guy?
Well, I thought it was, but maybe he just thought I was somebody else. Come on, let's go.
Oh, excuse us. Probably thought you were somebody else. Oh, yeah, I thought you were somebody else. Oh.
Where'd he go? Where'd he go? Would he take off?
Yeah. Come on, let's just go.
Would he take off? Big guy.
Oh.
Must have got scared. Big guy, huh?
Must have really hit him.
Yeah, I used to box. Not professionally, amateur, but I never lost a one. I really took a shot.
She looks better in a scuba suit than most girls look in bikinis. Mm-hmm. Anyway, Sunburn is light entertainment, and that's basically what it's intended to be. It's not a great thriller, it's not a great comedy, but it does have a nice sense of style, and it has some clever dialogue. And Sunburn also shows that Farrah has a nice, bright screen quality. She looks great in a scuba diving uniform, and what else are you going to ask for, Gene?
Well, I'd ask for a decent script.
I knew you would, yes. Yeah. Probably want it to make sense, too, don't you?
It's a mystery, it's a detective story. I think the people who wrote it even knew it was confused, because about two or three times while it's playing, they have to retell the story. Somebody says, now, we did this because of that, we did this because of that. And unfortunately, the film breaks down. For that reason and for one other one, it's hard. Farrah is very compelling visually. I mean, when you see her, you always look to the screen.
Yes, I noticed myself doing that, yes. Yeah.
But she's interrupting things. She's very beautiful. The script makes no sense, so it's an interruption.
I don't know. I think your one problem solves the other problem. This is not a tightly constructed mystery in which you're following the plots like Agatha Christie or something. She's very pretty. It's a movie about a pretty girl. That's one reason to have movies, especially in the summertime. To me, that's good enough rationale for Sunburn.
And all I'm saying is if it had made sense, if it had been a better script, it would have been nicer to look at. Well, let's get on to our next picture.
Okay.
One of the biggest film schools in Hollywood is the Mel Brooks Film School. Now, it's not a real school, but it sure has a lot of graduates. An actor appears in a Mel Brooks comedy, then the actor gets the idea that he can make a funny movie, too, by writing, directing, and starring in it. Some of the Mel Brooks alumni who've tried this are Marty Feldman, Gene Wilder, now Dom DeLuise, and they've all failed. They don't know how to make movies. In Hot Stuff, Dom DeLuise plays a burglary cop who's in hot water because his investigative team is making a lot of arrests, but they result in very few convictions. So, Dom DeLuise and his buddies set up a phony fencing operation to try and buy some stolen goods. They hide a camera behind a one-way mirror and hope to videotape the crooks. The first time they try it, however, they have trouble with the sound.
Hey, Louise, I was talking. Why aren't you talking?
I don't understand it. You see, the needle was moving. There must be something wrong with the microphone. You're just going to have to talk louder.
Louise, I thought you knew how to work this. There's no sound at all.
Do you want to work it?
Well, no, I can't work it. It's not my department. You're going to have to practice.
Hey, somebody's coming. Look.
Make him talk loud. Go on, go on, go on.
Hi, me? Wrong number. I made a mistake.
No, you didn't make a mistake. Come on in.
I'm in.
Yeah, you'll have to speak up. Yeah. Oh. He doesn't hear too well.
Oh.
The war.
The war? Vietnam?
Memphis. No, Brooklyn.
Oh. Where's Jaime?
Huh?
Where's Jaime?
Jaime? He's away.
Yeah. We're taking over. Have a cigar. Oh. Thank you.
What you got?
They're stones.
Louder. The war.
Oh, stones. Very fine quality.
I don't know. That one looks like it's been dead quite a while.
What kind is it? 215.
How much you want for those?
120.
Huh?
125.
You got it.
I do?
You do?
Huh?
What's your name?
Paulie Albedecker.
Albedecker.
Why is he writing it down?
Ask him.
Why is he writing it down?
Records for the boss.
Oh.
Paulie.
Huh?
Where'd you get them from?
Rabinowitz and Sons on Spring Street.
Spring, huh?
Jaime never wrote that down.
Well, why do you think they call us organized crime?
Huh? Oh, thank you. Nice doing business with you.
Come again.
I said it's nice doing business with you.
That's lousy. That whole scene plays like something out of a TV show. Too loud. It tries too hard to be funny. As for Dom DeLuise, we don't see him enough in Hot Stuff. He can be very, very funny in other people's movies, but obviously with Hot Stuff, he was too busy directing for the first time. I'm getting kind of sick of actors trying to direct as well. Why can't they just act?
Well, I kind of like the movie a little better than you did, although I really can't recommend it. But one thing I thought was a problem is that about two-thirds of the movie takes place on the same set. They're behind that pawn shop counter. A funny guy comes in with something funny to pawn. They do their shtick. Suzanne Pleshette is running the camera behind the one-way mirror.
Yeah.
It's repetitive after a while.
Yeah.
Another thing, though, that I want to bring up with you, you say that you don't think comic actors should direct. I think there's a tradition of comic actors directing themselves. You go back to Chaplin, Keaton. come up to Mel Brooks, Woody Allen.
Yes.
It seems to me that particularly in the area of comedy, which is a very tricky area to direct at all, a comedian perhaps has a better idea of his own personality, his own timing, than another director might.
Yes, but Brooks and Allen, to pick the modern guys, were also comic writers, and they knew structure. These guys are just comic actors with funny faces who just know how to do shtick, and they're developing a new tradition, which is that they can't direct. Wilder, DeLuise, Marty Feldman, they haven't made very good pictures. That's
well,
all I'm saying.
I'm not ready to dismiss any of them yet, so I think we'll differ right there and go on to another movie, okay? And this is summer, of course. Summer is a time when kids don't have much to do, and so they go to the movies. And that'd be great, except that a lot of the movies they go to are pretty violent and gruesome, especially for younger kids, say around junior high school age. One of this summer's biggest box office hits, though, is Meatballs, which is a movie aimed squarely at younger teenagers. I think it's pretty much on target for that audience. It stars Bill Murray from TV's Saturday Night Live as a senior counselor at a wacky summer camp where Murray spends most of his time trying to make out with another counselor.
Okay. An air conditioner just doesn't get up and walk away. Any idea where it might be, Tripper?
I have no idea.
Maybe it was stolen, Morty.
Of course it was stolen. But I'm gonna find it. Will you two go over the schedules, please?
Okay, ready? Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, 2 to 4 p.m. Junior boys and junior girls. Tuesday and Thursday, 2 to 4 p.m., junior boys. Thursday and Friday, 4 to 5.
Roxanne, I have to tell you this as a friend. I can see right down your blouse. See everything, too.
Tripper, is there something seriously wrong with you?
Roxanne, I have what doctors call very active glands. You're the only person I've told. My folks don't even know.
Well, maybe you can have surgery without them knowing.
Oh, heck with surgery. Let's wrestle.
I know, let's not, okay, Trevor?
No. Trevor! Oh, your time is gone, Crusher!
Let's not do this, okay, Trevor? Let's just stop right now, okay? Okay? Then, oh.
Shark infested waters!
Don't do that with Tripper! No, no! Tripper, no! Let's stop now, okay? No, let's stop.
I'm sorry about that last thing, but somebody had to tell you.
Tripper, get off me right now or I start screaming.
Oh, at the count of three, I guess, huh? One, two.
Help me! Somebody! Help! Get off me! Morty!
What the hell's going on here?
Oh, Morty!
What?
Oh, Morty, Morty. Oh, she attacked me.
Give me a break, Harrison.
Oh, she came out here like an animal.
That was Kate Lynch there attacking the helpless Bill Murray. The summer camp in Meatballs is a nonstop epidemic of practical jokes, making out, cheating in the camp Olympics, general chaos, and then there's a half-serious subplot involving a camper who's your standard, basic, shy little kid who looks up to the friendly counselor. Murray gives him self-confidence during a game of blackjack.
You bet.
Five.
I'll see that five. My card?
Yeah.
I'll take one. Eight. 15. 18, I'll stick.
20.
Shark!
Playing some sort of system, aren't you? Watching the cards, marking the cards. Annie up. What do you do in the off season?
Go to school. 20.
20? What are you, some sort of madman? So they teach in that school of yours? 20? I'll see your 20. I hope you walk out of here with nothing.
I think I like history the most. It's fun to imagine that I'm in some other time, in a different place.
Shut up and look at your cards.
Blackjack.
Murray creates kind of a nice feeling there, sort of a gruff sweetness, you might almost call it. Meatballs is a pleasant, cheerful, unassuming summer entertainment and has its heart in the right place. And Bill Murray does a good job of holding things together. He has a confident comic touch, kind of a nice warm quality I think kids appreciate. You like this guy, you know, watching the movie. And so for the right audiences, which is to say for younger audiences, I think Meatballs is a lot of fun.
Well, you're right. Murray does have a nice quality in the picture. I just was hoping this film would have been more like Animal House, sort of Animal House takes a vacation. I expected sort of a rougher, more lusty kind of comedy, and this film doesn't have that. So if you're going to see Animal House, this isn't the picture that they've made. It's a lighter piece, and that's my disagreement.
Okay, fine. It's not Animal House, but it's doing a lot of business. It's one of the biggest hits this summer because kids are telling each other about it. And when you get word of mouth like that, it must indicate in some way that they like what they see. So I think for younger kids, once again, I'll say, this is a good movie.
It's better than the Disney features, at least.
Yeah, it's better than watching some dragon fly around on Saturday afternoon.
Okay, I've got a much less successful comedy. This one's called Americathon. It's about an attempt to save the United States in 1998 by holding a huge telethon to raise money to pay back the national debt, which has become overwhelming in 1998 because of the oil crisis, of course. John Ritter of TV's Three's Company plays the president of the United States, who goes on TV to announce the telethon, while his most trusted aide, Fred Willard, is conspiring with Arab and Israeli leaders.
And this telethon is not only an incredible opportunity to save our country, but also an incredible opportunity for all of us to be responsible. It's incredible.
Incredible, incredible. Everything's so incredible. You know, it's really incredible that this moron is president. You want to know what his IQ really is, huh? 102, moron.
And I've learned that we're all on this planet together. Our brother countries have opened up their hearts to us and are sending us their finest performers. That is why we have allocated every last dollar available to us to make this telethon happen. Engineers have been working round the clock to connect a powerful steam generator to run the electrical equipment.
Complete idiot. He's taken Primal, he's taken TM, Scientology, yoga, ass, rolfing, and you know something? He's still an idiot.
And so, starting tomorrow, for 30 days and 30 nights, I hope that you'll all contribute your gold and other valuables to the Americathon. I'm Chet Roosevelt, your president, and I love you.
Horrible. Just like Hot Stuff, Americathon is a very noisy, TV-like movie. It's not feature film caliber. It's not feature film quality. There's no reason to pay $3-4 to see this picture. And when that telethon gets rolling, you're probably going to be turned off by the Vietnamese rock and roll singer on the show. At times, this is a very tasteless movie.
At times, it's worse than that. At times, this movie is a savage affront to the intelligence. This is one of the worst films I've ever seen, and one of the things I hated about it was that it took the intelligence of its audience so much for granted at a very low level. The audience is also an intelligence of 102, apparently, the way this film behaves. The decibel level is turned way up. They're screaming. They're shouting. It's as if a joke will be funny if they shout it loudly enough. It's not funny. It's one of the low points of my entire movie-going career.
I take it you didn't like Americathon. Now, Spot, no, you're not going to speak on the show. Go ahead and pout. And the reason is both Roger and I are sort of tired of knocking this summer's movies. There's no reason to give people then two more films not to see. So instead of our regular Dog of the Week feature, Roger and I have looked over the movies we reviewed on this summer on Sneak Previews, and we want to recommend again some of the films we think you'll enjoy. Why don't you start?
Okay, Gene, looking back over the summer of 1979, there were a lot of movies I liked enough to see more than once, and there are three in particular that I can really recommend. Now, way out in front, my choice as the summer's best movie is Breaking Away, the bittersweet comedy about four kids coming of age in Indiana. Now, if you only see one movie this summer, make it this one.
Would you like to give this man a kiss?
Ah, see.
I also liked Alan Arkin and Peter Falk in The In-Laws, a hilarious comedy in which they meet a Central American puppet dictator and his puppet. There was also the terrifyingly effective Alien, about a gruesome monster that terrorized an interstellar spaceship. It wasn't exactly a profound movie, but it kept you on the edge of your seat.
I've never seen anything like it.
I certainly agree with you on Breaking Away. It is one of the finest films of the year. Now, here are three more films from this summer that I can recommend. Rocky II, with Sylvester Stallone proposing marriage to Talia Shire as only Rocky Balboa could.
I was wondering if you wouldn't mind marrying me very much.
What'd you say?
If you wouldn't mind marrying me too much.
Yes. I'd like to marry you.
All right, two plays back.
And the pro football movie North Dallas 40. It's a strong R-rated drama, a look into the dark side of the Sunday game with Mac Davis and Nick Nolte.
You throw a partner, I'll catch it.
And The Muppet Movie, with Kermit the Frog following a rainbow across the United States to Hollywood. It's a fine, fine film for family viewing.
We've done just what we set out to do, thanks to the lovers, the dreamers, and you.
So, six good summer films. We still recommend them. I think most of them are still playing in theaters around the country. And don't be too downhearted, Spot. We're going to have a couple of dogs of the week for you on the next program. Now let's take another look at the new films we reviewed for the first time on this show. The CONCORDE Airport 79 was the fourth in a series that crash lands this time. Neither Gene nor I can recommend you see this PG-rated movie, and that's why there's a no next to both of our names. Sunburn starred Farrah Fawcett Majors in a comedy thriller set south of the border. I enjoyed Farrah's style and her looks. Gene thought the movie was a loser, so one yes and one no. We both voted no for Hot Stuff, though, Dom DeLuise's comedy about cops who posed as robbers. But we split on Meatballs, the comedy about summer camp. I thought it was good fun for younger teenagers, but Gene said, no, send this movie to camp. And finally, two loud no's, that's right, Spot, for Americathon, the futuristic satire that was one of the summer's worst films.
Well, you picked a good time to bark, because Americathon is really a dog of the year. Well, that's it for this show. Next time on Sneak Previews, we'll take a look at five more movies, including Real Life, a satire on documentary filmmaking, La Cage aux Folles, an offbeat sex farce from France, and Rich Kids, a bittersweet story of divorce seen through the eyes of two teenagers. Until then, see you at the movies.
Funding for Sneak Previews was provided by this station and by other public television stations.